It's here, Kraft Records. It's here, Small Batch. It's here.
Hey, Edward. Hey. Oh, thank you very much. Thank you.
Yeah, take care.
Okay, see you later.
Let's see this thing. So see, I didn't really do a box opening, so I fooled you. There you go. So this is the copy. I'll do a little shootout with my vinyl me, please. And then this will be shipped number 229 to Michael, 45 RPM in Germany. So he'll get a used copy after I abuse it here. And, you know, maybe play it around and borrow my neighbor's Crosby and play it.
Hey, this is Mazzy, and welcome back to my channel. We're going to talk about jazz today, and this is three parts. First is the Kraft Small Batch, the second release of Yusef Lateef's Eastern Sounds. Second, there's going to be some beautiful new releases that I got recently from Room Gramophone, the Norwegian avant-garde jazz fusion label, and then I'm going to end up with a couple of Tone Poets. So I'm going to talk a little bit about... It's unfair to compare them, but of course I have to compare them because what it comes down to is the music and enjoying the music and the enjoyment of the process, the buying process, as well as the listening and everything. And this is up in my main rig, and now you audiophiles out there will probably notice from the ambiance, this is not a dead room. But it's not a totally live room either. This is a living, multi-purpose area, and I like to enjoy my music where I live. Sometimes right directly in front of me is a sweet spot when I'm really concentrating, and sometimes I'm walking around. So take that into consideration as you kind of listen to this and watch this. The very beginning was my anticipation and excitement, because I'll try to be brief here. This second small batch Kraft purchase was a fucking shit show. It was announced that on a certain date, 10 a.m., you could buy it. I lucked out within several seconds. I purchased my copy I actually do have the original record, the Lush Life. I did get that one when it came out, 1,000 copies limited, and I just got this copy. There was a in America, it was delayed by almost 4 weeks. It sat in one supposedly post office hub in Illinois and with no movement for almost a month. And then after a lot of brouhaha, and could be coincidence, it could be the push of Kraft or the Postal Service, it moved, and within 2 days it arrived to me. I'm in Seattle, so from Chicago to Seattle. Once it moved, it got here fast. The packaging is still subpar as far as I'm concerned. The first time there were some damaged copies to people. Mine was not damaged. I already saw one online on Instagram that had a ding corner. When you're paying $100 for a limited edition record, you expect perfect. So Kraft, up the ante. Use those analog production type acoustic sounds type mailers with the big fins, because mine came out unscathed, but just barely. The corners of the exterior box were damaged. And also, work it out so everyone gets priority mail. You don't even have time to think. I don't even know if there was an upgrade. So when you're paying $100 for a record, media mail ain't the way to go. So that's just my call on it. When I buy from MoFi Acoustic Sounds, I usually get an upgrade, and usually not for much more money. So figure that out. I know it's new, and I'm not going to get into all the 1,000 copy thing. This is number 229. For those of you who watch my channel a lot, if you watch the Four Corners, this copy is not going to be mine for long. I'm just doing a preview. This copy is going out to Michael at 45 RPM in Germany. This is a copy, my gift in a way to Michael, because he has to have all the audiophile copies. I do not. Now, the beginning you heard two different versions, and I played Blues for the Orient, the second cut of this fabulous 1961 record from Yusef Lateef. I played, this is a Vinyl Me Please version. This one is on a kind of bluish clear swirl vinyl, which I couldn't give a fuck about, colored vinyl. This is number 300 of 750 copies. Again, this is number 229 out of 1,000 copies. I'm gonna tell you at the end of this which one's which. I'd like to know what you thought. Obviously, there was a difference in volume. You shouldn't really take the volume in effect. I had to go up and, like, one of the records I had to, like, turn up a little bit. Of course, some may say that's a better thing when you turn it up. There's more dynamics in it. Your call there. I know what I liked initially here, and I have since listened to both these records again straight through twice. So let's just show the small batch. Again, the ribbon. Interesting box. Now, I'm not one like my friend Michael and other people. I don't buy the big box sets. I don't buy the UHQRs, except one at the end of this video. I don't buy these limited editions, which when it's one record in a thick box, I think that's a waste. It's kind of like going back to CDs with the long boxes. I don't think it needs to be packaging like this. However, I totally get what they're doing here. They call this a linen cover. Doesn't seem linen to me, but I guess it's some kind of a fabric, but it seems plasticky. I like the dimensions of this. I like how they're kind of small and not fat like the Mobile Fidelity or the Acoustic Sound UHQR records. I don't like that. Now, comes with this little insert of technical information about the process of the one step. The single origin, as I'm calling it. Again, read elsewhere about this. Go to the Kraft website. One thing I got to say about this Kraft, and I hope you're listening out there, Kraft. This is the label. This is the small batch. I don't know if you can see this, but it's not very clean looking. There are scuffs. There are aberrations. It did not affect the sound. That's fine, you know, and I'm not a purist where I freak at it, but I see some skid marks. I don't know if it was inserting it into the sleeves, but it's not a perfectly clean record like I usually get with even Mobile Fidelity and I get with the Tone Poets. So you need to kind of work on that, Kraft. But it didn't affect the sound, so I'm happy there. But they do need to get their act together on how they're gonna roll these out, how they're gonna sell them, and try to escape the flippers, which will never happen. And I can't blame a craft or anyone else when the flipping happens, but they need a smoother process. And again, I'm gonna give them the benefit of the doubt because there's a learning curve. The music is beautiful. I've loved this record for a long time. I have a CD of it. I never had an original vinyl. It's very in that kind of Eastern Middle East sound. I love his flute playing. I love his oboe playing. And of course his saxophone playing. Really a great artist. I enjoy his records on Atlantic Records. This was originally on Prestige. This has the Prestige logo. Again, this is the Vinyl Me Please. And this is the Craft single origin, single batch, small batch. It's so confusing to me, sorry. Aside from this Moodsville, I don't know the original. I've never had an original copy of the cover. The photography, there's more contrast on this photography. It's rich black and white. I suppose this is how the original was, but I don't know that. There's a slight sort of greenish, grayish tint to it, which my guess is they're trying to emulate the original more, and I don't have that to compare it to. I prefer this sharp black and white, but again, you know, they're both slightly out of focus. So cover-wise, neither is great. The bad thing about the Vinyl Me Please is this shit-ass light cardboard. And it surprises me because I don't subscribe to Vinyl Me Please, but I bought some of their records like the Fiona Apple records, and they do the heavy quality cover. So I think an upgrade should have happened, and I think they should stop with these thin covers personally. That's my take. I don't like these really thin kind of crappy covers on this. And I don't really care about the colored vinyl, but I know that's a hipster thing that happens. But they're both great records and they're both limited editions. This, I think, cost $30, $35, as I recall. This is $100. Now, is it worth it? Another $65. Now, do you need this? I don't need this kind of stuff. I would rather go the Tone Poet route and have a $35 record and have a great quality cover and a great pressing, analog pressing. One thing I will say, I'm going to show this just because this is Craft. I'm a fan of the Craft of the Charlie Parker series they've done, the 10-inch Charlie Parker. This is the Chet Baker Riverside albums. And I tell you what, these are the ones that you can now get for about $25 a piece. These covers, with these glossy covers and tipped on jackets, are far superior than this new Yusef Lateef album. It is a tipped on jacket, it's a matte cover. Nice quality. Maybe it's just the nature of this particular title and photograph. I think these kick ass over this a lot. And these sound fabulous. Personally, I know Kraft wants to dip in this segment of higher end releases and limited edition releases. For me, personally, I would want this record like this record. In fact, maybe they should do, and maybe they will do a $25, $30 version of this like this. These are fabulous. I mean, they originally came out in a box set about a year and a half ago, 2 years ago. And over the last few months, they were released individually at the beginning of this year. They're selling fast. Hopefully, they'll be back in print. If you can't get these now, look for them because they're great records. And again, as you know, that one of the most popular Tone Poets records was Chet Baker Sings, which is, I think it's already going to be on its third pressing, and it's hard to get right now, but hold off and you'll be able to buy it at a regular price later. The Chet Baker box actually came with an outtakes record too, which you can't get individually. That's a fair way of making it. So my take on the music, the louder one obviously was the Vinyl Me Please version. And I started playing the beginning, the opening song, Plum Blossom, but it doesn't have a lot of dynamics because of the nature of the piece of music, because you don't have the whole group right there. It's a softer interlude. So I didn't really want to play that for you all to showcase, because it didn't show the entire quartet here of Yusef Lateef, Barry Harris, Ernie Farrow, and Lex Humphreys. I wanted you to hear a little of everything. So that's why I played the second track on this, a partial of the second track. This was the album that was the softer one. But this had great dynamics too. Which do I like better? Good question. I think there's not a big difference. Probably throughout, the Craft has more dynamics, a little more interesting, more subtlety, more nuances. I really like this a lot. I don't think I like it $65 more if I was just a buyer to get that box. So I really like this. The volume, I mean, initially, and this is where the loudness wars and people used to push that loudness button on their stereos, where there's a certain enjoyment from that and a certain intensity from that. Right off the bat when I played them, I enjoyed the Vinyl Me Please better. After a while, once I got my level set on each one and I put it through, this definitely, the Craft has the edge. But I don't think it's a big, big difference. Now, I don't know all the details about this. I know this was a Bernie Grundman cut. The Vinyl Me Please version was from the OJC cut, and I don't recall who did the original mastering. But it sounds quite good. So I would say, don't go out and spend $300 or $400 on the resale market for the Craft. If you got the Craft for $100, it's a great record. It sounds beautiful. The dynamics are wonderful. I wouldn't say, compared to Lush Life, that this is a fantastic sounding record if you're going that direction, but musically, it's wonderful. It's a gorgeous piece of music. I applaud they did this. Did it need to be a small batch edition for $100? Personally, I don't think so. So once I send this off in a few weeks, I'm looking forward to Michael in Germany's response to this on his system. Obviously, his system is much higher end. Just to let you know where I'm coming from, B&W 702 S2 speakers. My turntable is a Riga RP8 fitted with a Hannah ML card, which is an MC, a music coil cartridge, and I'm going through a Rotel receiver. So I have a nice rig, not a high-end rig like Michael has, and my room is probably not as dead as Michael. Some of you will, ding me points for having a flat screen behind my system. Michael has that big, giant, rolling-up glass door behind his, which I know he's going to do some room treatments in. But again, my listening style is different than some audiophiles. So this is just my take as a music lover, a music listener, someone who dabbles in these one steps, but doesn't really, I'm not going all in on the big box UHQRs or the Ultra Discs, the Mobile Fidelity Ultra Discs. So hope you enjoyed that. Let's move on to the next segment. A little bit of warning, these next three records are from the great avant-garde jazz, a little bit of fusion label out of Norway, Room Gramophone. Room Gramophone has some amazing records and some amazing record covers. This is a brand new record by Jetil Mulid. Totally butchered that one, but that's not why I'm here to pronounce these appropriately. It's called Piano, solo piano album. Listen to it for a bit. This is one of the most beautiful records I've heard in a long time. It's reminiscent of the 1970s Keith Jarrett solo records for ECM, Cullen Concert, Sun Bear Concerts, without the moaning of Keith Jarrett. And if you know those records, you know exactly what I'm talking about. I played this morning twice, Sunday morning, when I'm recording this. And it's absolutely a stunningly beautiful piece. I love this. It's a stunningly beautiful piece of music. That's all I can say. I'm gonna let that play as I show these. Came out in March of this year on Room Gramophone. Another record I recently got, it's also the same pianist with his trio, What You Thought Was Home. This came out in 2019 and I just got it. And it's really a great album too. Now this is a trio, so it's not the solo piano. What's interesting about this, there were certain themes that he was playing. Again, it's the same pianist, Kjetil Mjøll, I can't even pronounce it, but you can search this out, seek it out. Check my Instagram and you can see it. Another great cover on Room Gramophone from 2019. There are certain themes that I kept hearing in this that sounded very familiar, not in terms of, I don't know if it's inspiration. One in particular was the opening of Radiohead's Kid A, that piano thing. I heard it on a one track on here. Not the same at all, but the way he played those chords that reminded me of that very opening before it gets electronic. Also, there's a bit of one piece that reminded me of Aaron Copland, the American composer. That's very majestic, sort of themes of that American classical Copland-esque style of playing. I don't know if that was intentional or just me, because I know Copland's music so well. But this is such a beautiful record too, but it's more of a trio. It is easy in terms of, it could be a Sunday morning record, obviously not as minimal as this record, which is, you know, in a way, it's jazz, but it's in a way more neoclassical, I would say. But a beautiful ambient morning record. And then lastly, a record that is really amazing is Elephant Nine, Arrival of the New Elders. I think they've had like about 10 records out. This record came out a couple of months ago. Another beautiful cover, another record on Rune Gramophone. This is more fusion, electronic, psychedelic. Some of it reminds me of the early 70s Miles Davis, the electric period, the fusion electric period, like Live at the Fillmore, a little post Bitches Brew in a way. There's some of that too. So it'll go from the semi-intense to the electronic, a little moody style, but a gorgeous, gorgeous record, again on Room Gramophone. And this is Arrival of the New Elders, Elephant Nine. All their artists are Norwegian, and I highly suggest you check these out. In America, I think the best place you can get these is their Google and go to the website for Forced Exposure. Forced Exposure is the East Coast online retail outlet. I think they distribute all their records, so anything by Room Gramophone, you can get through them. Of course, you can order them directly out of Norway. Mine shipped directly from Norway. Actually, two out of the three, this one I got from Forced Exposure. Okay, now, Blood, Sweat, and Tears. Ultra One Step, Mobile Fidelity. I succumbed to this record. I resisted these for a long time. I don't think I'm gonna be getting a lot of these. They sell out very quickly, so if you're gonna get into these, you need to get them fast. I believe this one's already sold out. I paid about $20 over list price, so I think they're already going for more than that. So I did okay, but again, numbered edition of 6,000. This is an amazing sounding record. Now, I bought this record when it came out in 1968. On Columbia Records, and I didn't get it. I didn't understand it initially, and then I really got into it. And of course, the record hit big. In 1969, I saw them at the Open Coliseum. The Riding High, this was on the charts for well over a year or two. I got a little tired of this record too, because every friggin' crooner and television show and artist would cover You Made Me So Very Happy and What Goes Up, Spinning Wheel, all the songs. But this, it might be, and I, one of the first introductions to jazz. It's jazz fusion, it's rock and roll. It's a really, really beautifully recorded record. So it makes sense in a one-step process. And I hadn't listened to this record in a long time. And in my recent California road trip, I had this album on my iPhone, going through my CarPlay system. And this album came on, I put it on, and I listened to it, and I just realized again how wonderful this record is. and how great the drumming is on this record. So 45 RPM, again, a one-step program. Both this and the single batch uses highfalutin versions of special vinyl booklets, all this kind of stuff. But as much as I like this, and I do, double 45 RPM, I still would just prefer a regular, beautiful, tipped-on, Stoughton-style cover. To me, Music Matters Jazz SRX, for any of these things, would be the way to go. 45 RPM or 33. I usually prefer 33, but I understand why audiophiles like the sound of 45, and I do appreciate the difference, but in terms of flipping records, I would go for a 33 by far. But again, I don't need this big box on my shelves. I don't need this special doodah, special custom cover. I want the original artwork on the record. So I'm not quite the audience for this stuff, although this sounds amazing and I wanted to try one, and this seemed like a good one to try. Lastly, two new tone poets, Dexter Gordon, Donald Byrd, Kenny Drew, Niels Henning Ørsted, and Art Taylor, one flight up, Blue Note tone poet, and Passing Ships, Andrew Hill. This is the stunner of the two. They're both beautiful records, and they're so different, so it's almost unfair to compare. Black Fire, that came out with the first series of tone poets, is amongst my favorite. His stuff is unusual. This is a larger ensemble, and this is a beautiful sounding record. This is two LPs, and it's three sides. So it's gonna be a little more money, but again, these tone poets have these great Francis Wolfe photographs on the inset that emulate the Music Matters Jazz series. For my dollar, for my collection, for the mood, for the direction of my musical love and my music collection, tone poets are the way to go. Music Matters Jazz, yes, but they're basically extinct now. There's few left. They go for crazy prices. I prefer their SRX 33 and a thirds. These are not the special Hoodoo vinyl. I don't think that's necessary. I get it's supposed to be quiet. There's a certain extra something in those SRX and that super vinyl that, you know, it's one of those things that's it's hard to quantify. What is the best thing? Are the Kevin Gray Masters the best thing? Are the Bernie Grundman Masters the best thing? Is it the vinyl? Is it the pressing plant? But I think in the world of records in 2021, audiophile records, those craft records by Chet Baker, that whole style to me is the sweet spot in my collection. So I'm gonna stick with these more. The single batch, the one batch, I may try to get them to help my friends, and if I get them, well, so be, but I'm not gonna jump through hoops. I'll never pay over price. The one steps, the mobile fidelity, the UHQR, I'm gonna do on a limited basis. Yes, I have pre-ordered the Kinda Blue, mainly because the tape improvement and 33, and I will not go for the 45 on that. So that's it. So hope you like this. Hope I helped out. Put your comments below, and I'm curious your take on all this stuff. You know, I know people are, and my friend Michael is so entrenched in these limited audio editions and the 45 and the best quality pressing ever. I don't dive quite as deep as he does on those. Bottom line is just enjoy the music. Whatever direction you want to go, whether it's a limited edition, the OJC type pressings, the one step, just enjoy the music. That's all you can do. Don't hawk your house for these records. Enjoy. Mazzy loves you.